चैप्टर 17 ऑफ विराट पर्व राधेया एंड अश्वत्थामा। अर्जुन हैड रिमूव्ड द लायन बैनर ऑफ द मत्स्यास फ्रॉम द चैरियट एंड फिक्स्ड हिज ओन एप बैनर। ही ट्रैवल फास्ट टुवर्ड्स द बैटल फील्ड। ही ब्लू हिज फेम्ड कॉन्च देवदत्त। हिज चैरियट मेड द कैरेक्टरिस्टिक नॉइस। ही अप्रोच द फ्रंट। ही हैड द गांडीवा इन हिज हैंड। ही ट्वैंग द स्ट्रिंग। The noise struck terror into the hearts of the enemies. Arjuna had taken his stand. Drona was thrilled to hear the noise of the Kandiva and the tone of Devadatta. He looked extremely happy. He said, "Here comes Arjuna. We will have to return the cows and return to Hastinapura. I know that Arjuna will not be here long without destroying our entire army. Let us all go back. It is no use fighting." Duryodhana came to the presence of the Acharya. He said, "My lord, please do not talk like this. You are just discouraging the troops. You know the purpose of this expedition. We decided on it even in Hastinapura. The capture of the cows was just a pretext. The real and serious purpose was to bring the Pandavas into the open. I said, if the Pandavas appear in front of us before the 13th year has expired, we can send them back to the forest for a further period of 12 years. Arjuna has appeared now. Perhaps he is too hasty in revealing himself. Perhaps he thinks that his days of hiding are over. It is up to our revered grandfather to tell us clearly whether the 13th year has come to an end. Arjuna has come out into the open to protect the cows of Virata. We had decided that Susharma should attack Virata on the southern side on the 8th day after the new moon, and that we should begin our attack on the 9th day. So far, everything has worked out according to our plan. We do not know what has been done by Susharma. Either he has captured the cows and gone away, or he has been defeated by Virata. If the latter, we are officially here to help him since he is our dear friend. If he has been defeated and the Matsya king is coming here to fight with us, we must fight. Supposing that Susharma has defeated Virata and that Arjuna has come to fight on his behalf, even then we have to fight. What do I see now? Great warriors like Bhishma, Drona and Kripa just sitting in their chariots, all because Arjuna has come into the picture. What if he comes? Can he put so much fear into your hearts? Who is here prepared to go back to the city of Hastinapura without fighting, even if Indra or Yama comes to fight with us? If you, our preceptor, put fear into the hearts of these ordinary soldiers, what can I do? Should you not arrange the army and do what is needful? Please do not praise that Arjuna any longer. Please do something that will bring order to the ranks. They are all upset. You are saying the wrong things at the wrong time. You must stop this praise of Arjuna and think of us." Radheya came up and said, "It looks as though the entire army is nervous, thanks to the words of our Acharya. No one seems to be keen on fighting, but it matters nothing to me. Let it be Bhargava himself or Indra. Let it be Arjuna with Krishna. I am not worried. I will fight with them all single-handed. Let everyone watch me shoot my keen arrows at him. My arrows will fly like serpents. They will leave my bow like a continuous flow of oil. They will kill my enemy. I will make his banner fall to the ground like a tree uprooted by the gale. For 13 years now, I have been longing for this encounter with Arjuna. I am so happy that my dream is to come true. My arrows will fly so fast and so steadily that the string of my bow will be making continuous music like the drowsy murmur of summer bees. I will cover the body of Arjuna with 1,000 arrows. His bleeding form will look like a mountain covered by red flowers. I will capture Arjuna from his chariot like the sacred Garuda capturing the snake. I will please my lord and friend Duryodhana by removing an arrow from his heart, the arrow which has been hurting him for the last so many years. I am sure of it. As for you, who seem to be scared of Arjuna, you can all go away from here or stand on the battlefield and watch me fight with my enemy." Kripa said, "Radheya, you are always thinking of war and killing. One should fight only when it is absolutely necessary. When the general good can be affected without fighting, then fighting should be avoided. You do not like to admit that your opponent is greater than you. Arjuna can fight with anyone single-handed, but you cannot. He allowed the Khandava forest to be burnt and he defeated Indra, who tried to defend the forest. He did it single-handedly. Recently, he was the one to rescue Duryodhana from the Gandharvas with just his brothers to assist him. He did not take an army with him. If I remember right, among those who went there with an army, one great hero ran away from the fight, jumping off his chariot. I do not have to relate all the achievements of Arjuna. You know them all only too well. You have heard about the killings of the Kalakeyas and the Nivata Kavachas. It was all done single-handed. It is no use talking about the greatness of your enemy to you. Still, I have to talk since I do not want you to make a fool of yourself. You are trying to remove the poison fangs from the mouth of a serpent by putting your right hand into its mouth. Arjuna is like a lion which has just come out of its captivity. Nothing can equal his fury. He will be like a spark of fire dropped on a pile of cotton. You and I and all of us will be burnt up in no time if this fight is allowed to begin. If, however, you are bent on fighting, do not try to tackle that forest fire single-handed. Let us arrange our troops properly. All of us will have to meet him as a single unit. The six of us, Drona, Duryodhana, Bhishma, your good self, Ashwatthama and myself, must meet him combining our efforts. Your talk about fighting with him just by yourself is, I am afraid, too optimistic. You do not know what you are saying. You think too much of yourself and too little of Arjuna. Radheya was wild at the tone of contempt which Kripa used. He said, I can see that the great Kripacharya has lost his nerve on seeing Arjuna. Those who are afraid need not fight. I can alone repay the debt I owe to my friend Duryodhana by killing Arjuna. Radheya turned to Duryodhana and said, Brahmins, my lord, are fit to be in the council only on certain occasions. They are good to consult when alms are to be distributed or when a feast is to be given. They should not be consulted when a war is to be fought. Let this great Acharya Kripa go home. He is afraid of Arjuna. I will fight. Ashwatthama was listening to this talk for quite some time. His anger now became uncontrollable. He looked at Duryodhana and Radheya. He said, you have not done anything about defending the cows so far. You are not doing anything. You are just listening. Duryodhana, to your dear friend and his plans about what he is going to do. The cows have not left the boundary of the Matsya kingdom. They have not reached Hastinapura yet. Please talk after you have done something to talk about. Radheya, listen to me. Brahmins are all righteous. They do not brag. Wise men do not brag. As for you, you are just a pompous braggart. You cannot do anything. Those who act do not talk about it. Look at the fire. It cooks food for the entire world. Does it talk about it? Look on the sun. He does more work in one moment than all the other gods put together. Does he make a song about it? Does he say, look at me, I am doing so much work. Come and be amazed. Look on this mighty earth. She bears the burden of animate and inanimate things. She has been patient for thousands of years. Does she talk about it and say, look on me and admire my patience? I am doing so much. Am I not wonderful? She does not. All of them do their work silently without talking about it. But you seem to be of a different caliber. You can only talk. Ashwatthama turned to Duryodhana and said, Brahmins do not win kingdoms by playing dice. Real heroes do not cheat at games and then talk as though they have won a kingdom in a battle. You are a great king indeed, Duryodhana, but you are worse than a Vaishya. A Vaishya is good at selling and cheating. You call yourself a Kshatriya. Which Kshatriya has won his kingdom by cheating his opponent? Cheating him in a game of dice? Of all things, you are worse than a Vaishya. He cheats because it is his profession. But you have adopted a profession which is far inferior to your class and your glory, and you glory in your dishonesty. Is it so wonderful after all to enjoy a kingdom won by cheating? Did you win the beautiful city of Indraprastha by fighting for it? Did you make Yudhishthira and his powerful brothers your slaves by taking them captives in a war? Did you win the fiery Draupadi as your slave in a fight with the Pandavas? No. The great Kaurava Duryodhana won them all in a game of dice. Even that game you did not play yourself. You had to have the help of that crooked uncle of yours for that. You felled at one stroke that sandalwood tree called Yudhishthira. Do you remember what Vidura said? The wise man said, the creatures of the earth inherit to a certain extent the patience and forgiving nature of Mother Earth. Even insects and ants forgive if they have to. But you have transgressed the rules of conduct so far in the case of the Pandavas that their minds will not be for forgiveness. You went too far when you insulted their queen Draupadi. Their anger is terrible. This Arjuna has now appeared as your nemesis. He has come to avenge their wrongs. Please do not insult my father and my uncle by calling them cowherds. They can face Indra and the entire host of the heavens. They are not afraid, as your dear friend seems to suggest. They can recognize greatness wherever they see it. They admire Arjuna because he deserves their admiration. They talk despairingly of Radheya since they know that he is nothing in front of Arjuna. I will say it too. Who can equal the greatness of Arjuna? He is the greatest of all heroes. Because of his skill and his noble nature and his chivalry, he is dear to the heart of my father. I do not see anything wrong in giving praise ungrudgingly where it is due. Your dear Radheya has always been jealous of Arjuna. As for you, you have ruined all your noble qualities because of this one fault in you, this envy for the 5 Pandavas. Let anyone fight. I have decided not to fight. If Virata comes to fight, then I will help you. But I will not assist this Radheya in his fight against Arjuna. Arjuna is as dear to me as he is to my father. Ashwatthama threw down his bow and arrows and sat down silent in his car. Krishnarpanamastu. Chapter 18 of Virata Parva, Duryodhana's heartbreak. Bhishma intervened. He said, what Drona says is true. I think Kripa's words are also right. The great Ashwatthama spoke only the truth when he explained the feelings which prompted the Brahmins to speak those words. They should not be insulted as they have been by Radheya. Duryodhana, consider the circumstances. You do not think of them at all. In your love for your friend, you allow this to happen. You must not allow this dissension to take place. There must not be any dissension in the army. You must pacify these great men. You must not allow our heroes to fight among themselves. Bhishma looked at Ashwatthama and said, you must not be offended by the words of Radheya. He spoke those words since he wanted the troops to be encouraged. The time is not right for you to show your anger. You must forgive their rash talk. You three must forgive these youngsters. They thought that the words of your father and your uncle spoke in admiration of Arjuna may ruin the morale of the army. That is the reason why Radheya spoke so vehemently. Please be good enough to forget these things and concentrate on the immediate danger. We must all combine and attack Arjuna. Wise people have short memories. Ashwatthama was slightly mollified by the words of Bhishma. He said, let my father forgive them. Let my uncle forgive them. I will not be angry if they give up their anger. I only thought that the merits of the enemy need not make this man jealous. Duryodhana realized the gravity of the situation. He asked Drona and Kripa to forgive them. He made Radheya also to ask them for forgiveness. Drona said, my anger vanished as soon as I heard the words of Bhishma. Let us now forget this talk. Let us make arrangements so that Arjuna does not meet Duryodhana in the fight. I know that Arjuna has not revealed himself before the expiry of the 13th year. The exile of the Pandavas is over. Arjuna's anger against Duryodhana will be terrible. Let us avert this meeting. I have no doubt that their period of exile is over. I request our revered Bhishma to clear the doubts of dear Duryodhana. Bhishma looked with pity at Duryodhana and said, "My child, Drona is right. Their term is over. The revolution of the wheel of the time is steady. The stars and planets, however, have their effect on its progress. Astrologers have calculated every movement which slips by unnoticed by us. According to them, every 5 years there is an increase of 2 months in the length of time. During these 13 years, there has been an increase of 5 months and 12 days. The Pandavas have spent their 12 years in the forest and 1 year in hiding. But they have spent 5 months in unnecessary exile. This must have been known to Yudhishthira and to the four brothers of that gentle soul. Yudhishthira is very righteous and very noble. He did not want to lessen the final year by these 5 months. With his brothers, he has allowed himself to suffer that also in silence. He did not want to shorten this year. He does not want any argument about the exile. He does not want any hair-splitting arguments about the facts. Therefore, he stayed silent. Arjuna knows that the 13th year is gone. That is why he has come out into the open. Even that he has done because he wanted to help the king. He wanted to help his king. The Pandavas, who are bound by the shackles of Dharma, will never transgress it. They will never tell a lie. If Yudhishthira says that the term of the exile is over, it is over. That is all." He waited for a moment. Then he continued, "Look at this Arjuna. He cannot be conquered. If he and his brothers decide to fight with us, we have no chance of defeating them. I am very fond of you. I do not want to see you destroyed. This is your only chance. Why do you still think of them as your enemies? Return their kingdoms to the Pandavas. Make peace with them. You will be happy. All the world will be spared from slaughter. Take my advice. Summon the Pandavas to your presence and return their kingdom to them." Duryodhana's face was pale with disappointment. All his dreams of sending them back to the forest were gone forever. His eyes became red with anger. He said, "I will not return their kingdom to the Pandavas. Let us now talk about war and nothing else. I am going to fight now and later too. Please make all arrangements for the war now." Drona said, "Please take my advice. Let us divide the army into 4 parts. Duryodhana, you take 1/4 of the army with you. You must proceed towards Hastinapura." He looked at the others and said, "The king must be guarded at all costs. We must not allow an encounter between Duryodhana and Arjuna. Let another 1/4 of the army take the cattle and proceed towards Hastinapura. The other 1/2 of the army will remain here and fight with Arjuna. Bhishma, Kripa, Ashwatthama, Radheya and myself will fight with Arjuna. Even if Indra himself comes to his aid, we will not care. But now the noise of Arjuna's chariot can be heard. He is coming fast. Let us hurry and dispatch the king to the capital." Bhishma took entire charge of the situation. He made the army arrange itself properly. He said, "Let Drona be in the middle of the phalanx. Let Ashwatthama stand to his left and guard the left wing. Let Kripa guard the right wing. Radheya will be at the front, the van of the army. I will be at the back defending the rear of the army. 5 of us can manage to defy him, I think." They were ready. The chariot of Arjuna came fast in their direction. Arjuna looked at the army arrayed in the form of a crescent. It was called Vajravyuha. It meant that it was as hard as a diamond to penetrate. Arjuna smiled to himself. He said, "This must be the arrangement of my grandfather. He is skilled in the arrangements of the army in these diverse phalanxes." He looked again and saw the banner of his grandfather. It was the golden palm tree, the sight of which would always strike terror into the hearts of his enemies. Shri Krishnarpanamastu. Chapter 19 of Virata Parva, the routing of the Kaurava army. Out of the air there flew two arrows which fell at the feet of Drona. Bhishma and Kripa too were greeted by two arrows each falling at their feet. Two more arrows came. They brushed past the ears of Drona. Bhishma and Kripa too heard arrows whispering past their ears. They were pleased with this. It was a very beautiful gesture on the part of Arjuna. The first two were his salutation. He had met them after 13 years. He was announcing himself. The next two were sent asking them for permission to fight with them. The fight began. Arjuna advanced with the speed of wind. He looked at his opponents. He told Uttarakumara, "I can see that this phalanx is arranged like this to bar my way. I can see the Kuru veterans here and I can see Radheya, but I cannot find Duryodhana. There a portion is proceeding towards Hastinapura. I can see their plan. They do not want me to meet Duryodhana. He is going away with the cows and a portion of the army too. Come, let us pursue him. We must first release the cows." Uttarakumara steered the chariot in the direction which Arjuna indicated. They went along the western wing. Arjuna fought as he went along. Several of the brothers of Duryodhana opposed him, but they could not stop him. He was set on pursuing the banner of Duryodhana, the serpent embroidered on a cloth of gold. Arjuna said, "I am not keen on fighting with anyone else. I want to rescue the cows and I want to meet this man who has caused us untold harm. I want to meet this man, this proud, haughty monarch who has caused our queen so much pain. I want to kill all those who laughed at us then. But the king has escaped my sight. This might be the work of Drona. I am sure he wants to save the life of the king, or else the king Duryodhana will never run away from the battlefield. I must pursue him. Do not pay any attention to this army. Go in the direction where we can see the serpent banner." The chariot rolled past Bhishma. He looked at Arjuna and divined his intentions. He told the others, "Arjuna is pursuing the king like a lion its prey. We cannot let him vent his anger against the king now. He will kill him in no time. Let us not worry about the cows now. We must meet Arjuna." Bhishma hurried to the help of the king. Arjuna had reached the portion of the army which was leading the cattle away. He asked Uttarakumara to proceed slowly. He said, "Let us first release the cows." He fought with the soldiers who were guarding the cows. They were overpowered by the terrible arrows which poured out of his bow in an unending stream. The guards were made to run away. With their tails raised, with their calves running with them in fear, the cows of Virata turned back and began to run in the southern direction. They were going towards the city. The cowherds were happy that the cows had been released. Arjuna's chariot was going towards the king, who had 1/4 of the army to guard him. The veterans watched the maneuvers of Arjuna. They prepared themselves to meet him and impede his progress. The phalanx was also broken up. Radheya, Bhishma and others proceeded towards Arjuna. Arjuna tried his level best to avoid wounding his guru Drona. He faced the brothers of Duryodhana. Fighting them all along, he reached the spot where Radheya was advancing towards him. Arjuna said, Uttarakumara, look, this man is Radheya. He has ever been my rival. He is a great archer. He is a disciple of Bhargava. He is a master of all the many divine astras. He is unparalleled in valor and in skill. He is a great hero. Take me to him. Look, the king has returned. Look at the serpent banner advancing towards us. I am glad he is coming. I knew that Duryodhana will never be a coward and run away from the battlefield. He is also coming here. Bhishma, my dear grandfather, is coming towards us. He is bent on protecting the king. Bhishma is the greatest of the Kuru heroes. He has now become a soldier in the army of Duryodhana. Yes, they are all of them, every one of them, under the magnetism of Duryodhana. I want to fight with all of them. Take my chariot to the center of the field from where I can fight. The chariot advanced rapidly. Ashwatthama smiled at Radheya as if to say, let us see what you are going to do now. Your chance has come. He said, Radheya, look, Arjuna is coming, eager to fight with you. For years, you have been making the council hall resound with your talk about how you will kill Arjuna. He is now here, roaring like a lion in the arena. Let us see you fight. If you are beaten, you can go back to the council hall at Hastinapura and confer with the crooked-minded Shakuni about some other shady trick to banish the Pandavas once again. Radheya's eyes spat fire. He said, please do not keep on taunting me. I am not afraid of Arjuna. I have never been afraid. I am not afraid of even Krishna. You can see how I can fight. I will show you. Arjuna advanced with a smile on his face. Duryodhana had reached the center of the field. He was ready to fight. Arjuna was surrounded on all sides by the great heroes of the Kaurava army. Bhishma, Drona, Kripa, Ashwatthama, Duryodhana, Radheya, Shakuni and Vikarna. It was a terrible fight. They all fought with him, all together and one by one. Arjuna was undaunted. He was bent on fighting with Radheya. He concentrated on him. Arjuna singled out Radheya. The fight was wonderful. All the others stood spellbound as they watched the duel. Both were great archers. Both vied with each other in valor and in skill. Arjuna was as angry as the heavens when they rained destruction on the earth. He said, come, Radheya, let us now settle some old scores. You have taken an oath that you will kill me and I have sworn that I will kill you. Let us see who is to win and keep his word. I have heard you talk. I have heard you say that there is no one to equal you in skill and in bravery. The time has come when you will have to prove your statements. I will see how you are going to escape alive from me. Radheya laughed and said, I am just as keen, my dear Arjuna, to fight with you and fight to a finish, a duel with you. I do not want to waste my time in empty talk. Come, let us fight. They fought for a long time. The arrows of Radheya were so swift that their path could not be followed by the eye. They were sharp. They wounded Arjuna and his horses and his charioteer too. Uttarakumara stood his ground. The young prince had become a hero all on a sudden. So great was the influence of Arjuna. His bravery was contagious. For a long time, Radheya withstood the onslaught of Arjuna. But finally, he had to admit defeat. His forehead, his neck, his shoulders, his arms, his broad chest were all covered by the arrows of Arjuna. Radheya had to give up fighting. He had to abandon the fighting and run away from the field. Arjuna encountered Drona. Ashwatthama came to the help of his father. When he found that Arjuna was winning, Arjuna was like a forest fire burning up everything that came in his path. Drona, Ashwatthama and Kripa were all defeated by Arjuna. He was like some divine fighter. He looked like no ordinary mortal. Bhishma came to their help. Arjuna defeated every one of them. He wanted to meet Duryodhana. He went in the direction where Duryodhana was stationed. The two encountered each other. The king was already disappointed at the way things were shaping. He found his army being scattered in all the four directions by Arjuna. He opposed Arjuna valiantly, but he could not fight for a long time. Arjuna killed his horses and elephants. Duryodhana could not withstand this powerful cousin of his. He had to run away from the field. Arjuna followed him with the words which were sharper than his arrows. He said, "You have today abandoned your fame and your reputation on the field of battle. Is it right for a Kshatriya to be such a coward? Are you so fond of this life of yours that you are prepared to lose your name in exchange for it? What is life after all? A few moments? What is life after all? A few moments? You are behaving like a cowherd. Death on the battlefield is more to be desired than such a life. They have named you Duryodhana. It means that it is very hard to oppose you and fight with you. They call you Suyodhana. It means that you are a good fighter. You have today made both your names meaningless by this your behavior. You ought to be ashamed of yourself. Come, be a man and fight." Stung by these cruel words of Arjuna, Duryodhana came back to fight. He fought like a wounded serpent. His pride was wounded. He had always been highly sensitive. He could not bear the insults that were being heaped upon him. Radheya came to his support on the right side, but it was not possible to defeat Arjuna. Drona and the rest of them came up and surrounded Arjuna once again. Arjuna decided that he had caused enough havoc in the army. He invoked the astra called Sammohana. It had the power of making them all go into a trance. Prince Uttarakumara saw the entire army fall down as if in a faint. Arjuna remembered the request of the princess Uttara. He told Uttarakumara, "They are all under a trance. Get down from the chariot. Go near them and bring their mantles and upper cloths. Go to Kripa and remove from his shoulders the white silk he is wearing. Look at that beautiful yellow cloth which is lying on the chest of Radheya. Bring that. Go to Ashwatthama and bring his apparel also. The king is sporting a blue silk. That looks lovely. Your sister will like it, I am sure. Collect that. Do not go very near my grandfather. He knows the counter incantations for this astra of mine. He may not be under a trance. Let us not risk going near him." Uttarakumara leaped down from the chariot. He collected silks and jewels from the sleeping heroes. He came back to the chariot. They were ready to depart. Bhishma tried to stop the chariot, but his horses were killed by Arjuna. After saluting Bhishma from that distance, Arjuna returned to the outskirts of the city. They all got out of the trance. They wanted to pursue Arjuna, but Bhishma laughed at them and said, "Do not be foolish. Admit that we have been defeated. Let us return to Hastinapura. I saw your dresses and your jewels being taken from you. That means that you have been stripped of your honor. A fitting revenge for what you did to them years back. I tried to stop him, but I could not. He could have killed all of you while you were sleeping, but he is too righteous to do that. Let us go back to Hastinapura." Duryodhana was silent. His plans had all gone awry. He saw the chariot of Arjuna in the distant horizon. From there, Arjuna sent arrows to fall at the feet of the elders. He took leave of them. He took leave of the king by sending an arrow which felled his crown on the ground. The chariot had gone beyond their sight. With a sigh of heartbreak, Duryodhana decided to return to Hastinapura. Arjuna descended from the chariot. He said, "By the grace of God, the cows have been saved. The enemies have been defeated. Send out a message to the city announcing your victory. I want to give you a word of warning. Do not let your father know that the Pandavas are in his court. If he hears it suddenly, your father may not be able to stand the shock. Tell him that you fought with the Kaurava army and that you rescued the cows which had been captured by them. Uttara Kumara said, "But that is impossible. The days of my bragging are over. I cannot take credit for something I did not do." Arjuna said, "Say so for the time being. When the proper time comes, you can tell him the truth." They proceeded towards the Sami tree. The lion banner was placed on the chariot and the ape banner removed. The great Gandiva was tenderly wrapped up and placed with the other weapons. The two proceeded towards the city. Uttara Kumara was now sitting in the chariot and Arjuna was driving it. His hair, which had been bound up with a cloth during the fight, was once again hanging down his back in a plait. Shri Krishna Arpanamastu. Yudhishthira's Blood, Chapter 20 of Virata Parva. King Virata entered the city in triumph after the Trigartas had been defeated. He had rescued the cows. He was received by the citizens with great pomp and splendor. He entered the city surrounded by the Pandavas. At the palace, he was received by the queen and his daughter. The princess Uttara told him about the invasion of the Kaurava army and about the young prince Uttara Kumara going to fight with them single-handed. The king was unhappy at this calamity which had befallen him. He was told that Brihannala was the charioteer of the prince. He was sunk in depths of despair. He said, "What can my child do? The great Kaurava heroes are there. Bhishma, Drona, Kripa and the invincible Radheya have all come to attack us. What can my son do? Let me collect my army immediately and go to help my son." I thought that all danger had been averted when Susharma had been defeated. I did not bargain for this new danger. I must collect my army at a moment's notice. He was giving instructions to his ministers and his brothers to make arrangements for a second campaign. Then spoke Yudhishthira, "Do not give way to despair. Having heard that Brihannala is the charioteer to your son, I am not worried, not in the least. Your son will be able to vanquish even Indra or Yama if Brihannala is his charioteer. I know Brihannala and her greatness. Please compose yourself, my king. Please wait for news from the battle front. I assure you that you will soon hear about the success of your son." Hearing the words of Yudhishthira, for whom he had very great respect, the king agreed to be silent. He had to be patient. His heart was heavy with grief. But he agreed to wait for news from Uttara Kumara. A few hours of agony passed. Then came some cowherds to the presence of the king. They said, "My lord, we have come from the neighborhood of the battlefield. We saw the prince's chariot being driven by Brihannala. Seeing us, the chariot stopped. Brihannala said, 'Go at once to the city and announce that the prince has routed the enemies, that he has rescued the cows, that the city should prepare itself to receive him with honor. The prince is coming to the city after having rescued the cattle from the Kauravas. He has defeated them all in a single combat.'" The cowards were so excited that they repeated themselves again and again. Yudhishthira smiled at the message and said, "It is fortunate that success has wooed the king and his son." He added, "But I am not surprised at this. I knew that the prince was sure to win since Brihannala is his charioteer. The charioteer of Indra by name Mathali and even Krishna, the greatest of all charioteers, will pale into insignificance in front of this Brihannala." The king was delirious with joy. He gave orders for the city to be decorated. He wanted the city to welcome his son in a glorious manner. His orders were all carried out. The king was happy. The palace was a garden of happiness. The king and Yudhishthira were sitting together. The king's eyes fell on Sai Randri, who was standing at a distance attending to the decorations in the hall. He called out to her, Sairandri, go and bring the dice. I am so happy. I want to play now. Yudhishthira said, if I may offer my advice, please do not play. Please do not let us play now. The wise forbid the game when the mind is not normal. The king said, but that is absurd. We are not playing the game using any stakes. We are just trying to while away the time. There is no harm in the game if it is played now. Come, let us play. Yudhishthira said, no, my lord, this game is a terrible thing. I know why Yudhishthira lost his kingdom and his brothers and his wife too, as stakes in this game of dice. The game of dice robs a man of sane thinking. If Yudhishthira had been in a normal frame of mind, he would never have been so foolish. The game goes to the head like wine. It makes a man do the worst things imaginable. You are excited. I am afraid for you. Please do not let us play. But the king was very keen on playing. So Yudhishthira had to agree. The game began. Virata's mind was full of the victory of his son. Yudhishthira too was just as excited as the king. The success of Arjuna thrilled him. The king said, I am proud of my son's achievement. To think that he has fought with all the heroes on the side of the Kauravas makes me so happy and excited. I am indeed proud of my son. He has done a great thing. He has achieved the impossible. Yudhishthira said, yes, it is your good fortune that Brihannala was there to hold the reins of your son's horses. That was why the prince was able to win. The king did not like the words of Yudhishthira. He became very angry. He said, you say that you are not surprised, is it? Then such an easy thing to defeat the heroes in the Kaurava army? It is a great achievement. You keep on talking about that eunuch as though he is someone great. I tell you, my son is a great hero. You are insulting him and me by talking less of him and more about this dancer. I will excuse you this once, but please take care not to displease me again. Yudhishthira smiled gently and said, truth, my lord, is never pleasant to hear. I will tell you what must have happened. Please announce to the citizens about the victory of Brihannala. It is sure to be as I say. When I say a thing, it will always be true. I know that your son must have been the charioteer to Brihannala. She must have been the one to defeat the Kaurava army. Think of that army. It cannot be faced even by the Devas. How can a child like your son be able to defeat them? Only Brihannala would have been able to achieve this victory. The king was beside himself with anger. He took the dice in his hand and threw them forcibly at the head of Yudhishthira. Yudhishthira tried to prevent the dice from hurting him, but he was hit. It hit him on the forehead. Blood began to flow from the wound on his forehead. He would not let the blood fall to the ground. Yudhishthira cupped his hands and received the blood in his hands without letting a single drop fall on the ground. He cast a look of pain at Draupadi. She rushed to him with a bowl of gold filled with water. Draupadi washed his hands in it. Draupadi wiped the brow of Yudhishthira with her garment and tried to stop the bleeding. It was only then that Virata saw what was being done. He asked Draupadi, Sairendri, what are you doing? Why are you wiping the blood from the wound of this foolish Brahmin with your silken garment? Draupadi said, if a drop of blood from the body of this good man touches the ground, your kingdom will not have rain for 1 year. Every drop means 1 year of famine. If this blood falls on the ground, you will be killed by one who has sworn to do it. To save you and your kingdom, I am preventing this precious blood from flowing. Virata did not attach any importance to the words of Draupadi. He was still angry with Yudhishthira for his words. A messenger entered the hall. He said, the prince is now in the city. He has reached the gates of the palace. He is even now entering the apartments of the king with his companion Brahmanala. Yudhishthira spoke to the messenger in secret. He said, Please see to it that they do not enter the hall together. Allow the prince to come in. Keep Brahmanala back. Let her enter after a little while. I am saying this for the good of your king. His very life depends on your doing what I ask you to do. Please see that Brahmanala does not enter along with the prince. The prince Uttarakumara entered the hall. He was embraced warmly by his father. Uttarakumara looked beyond him and saw the face of Yudhishthira covered with blood. His heart stopped beating. He was horrified at the sight. He said, "Who has done this cowardly act towards the noblest of the men? Who has been indiscreet enough to tread on the tail of a cobra? Who has committed this dastardly crime?" The king smiled and said, "I hit him with the dice. He annoyed me by praising your charioteer and belittling your prowess. So I hit him." The prince said, "Father, you do not know what you have done. Please ask his pardon, nay, his forgiveness immediately. Please do not invite the curse of God on yourself." The king was puzzled by the words of his son. His anger against Yudhishthira, however, had vanished as soon as he saw his son. He went to Yudhishthira and asked him to pardon him. The blood had now stopped flowing, thanks to the efforts of Draupadi. Yudhishthira said, "I was not angry with you at all. I was worried about your welfare. I did not want this blood of mine to fall on the ground. If it had, you would have been killed at once, but I have averted the calamity. Nothing can happen now." The king could not make out anything of the words of all of them. Brahmanala entered the hall. The king was praising the prowess of his son. The poor prince did not dare to look up and meet the eyes of Arjuna. He said, "Father, I was aided by a divine person. I could not have won but for his help. He defeated them all single-handed." Uttarakumara related to him all that had happened on the battlefield. Without mentioning the name of Arjuna, he spoke about his valor. The king was amazed to hear about this divine being. He said, "I want to meet this person. I must thank him. I will give him all that I have. I will give my daughter to him. Bring him to me." Uttarakumara said, "He vanished from my sight. He may appear tomorrow or the day after." The king thanked Brahmanala formally for having driven the chariot for his son. Arjuna left the presence and went to the apartments of the princess. He gave her the silks and jewels which he had bought for her. All the while, Arjuna was intrigued by the behavior of Yudhishthira. While Uttarakumara was related to Virata the events that took place on the battlefield, Arjuna had tried to see how Yudhishthira would take it. He tried to catch his eye, but the eldest Pandava had been keeping his face averted. He would not turn his face in the direction of the Arjuna. This was causing him a lot of unhappiness. Arjuna thought of winning a smile of sly mischief from his brother. He could not rest until he knew the real reason for his behavior. Arjuna went to Bhima and asked him, "Why is Yudhishthira different? He does not look at me with affection as he used to. Is he angry with me because I fought with the Kauravas?" "I had to," Bhima said. "I cannot explain it. Come, we will go to our brother and ask him." Together, they went to Yudhishthira. He saw them and embraced Arjuna warmly. They looked at the wound on his forehead and looked at him questioningly. Yudhishthira said, "Do not think about it now. The king hit me with the dice. He told them everything." He continued, "I was hurt badly. Arjuna, I do not want you to see it when you entered the hall. That is why I kept my face averted." Bhima was very angry. He said, "If only you had shown your anger against this Virata, he would have been dead long ago. Without knowing who you are, he has insulted you. I cannot bear this. We must punish him." Arjuna said, "My lord, Your patience has been your undoing all these years. I will kill this man and all his relations. We will then kill all the Kauravas. I am not pleased with your patience. I am going to kill Virata. Bhima said, Arjuna is right. We will destroy the Matsyas with their relations and their friends. It is because of the spineless behavior of Virata that Draupadi was harassed by Kichaka. Let us become lords of Matsya first. We can then become lords of the world. Yudhishthira said, Compose yourselves. There is no need to kill him. He insulted me without knowing who I am. We will give him a chance. We will show him who we are tomorrow morning. We will occupy the throne. If he dares to defy us, then we will kill him. Not till then. Let him realize what he has done. If he is impertinent to me, we will all kill him and his people after that. But not now. Shri Krishnar Panamast. Chapter 21 of Virata Parva. After the eclipse, the full moon. It was a beautiful morning. The five brothers got up early in the morning. They bathed themselves in perfumed water. They dressed themselves in costly robes made of soft silk. They put on gleaming jewels. They went to the court of Virata. Yudhishthira ascended the throne. Draupadi sat by his side. The four brothers sat all around him. They waited for the king to come. After a while, the king entered the hall with all his attendants. He was followed by his ministers and his many courtiers. He looked at the Pandavas glowing like fire and was amazed at the sight. He looked at Yudhishthira and said, Kanka, you are the dice player in my court. I had granted you several privileges because I thought that you were an honorable man. It does not mean that you should dress yourself in my silks and sit on my throne. I do not like your behavior. Explain yourself if you value your life. Yudhishthira smiled at the angry king. He said nothing. Arjuna said, Virata, please be careful. You do not know what you are saying. This man here is fit to sit with Indra on the same throne. He is the greatest soul that has been born on this earth. He is a lion among kings. He is Yudhishthira, the Pandavas. His fame will live in this world as long as the sun shines and sets. As long as the sun rises and sets. This is the king who was surrounded by thousands of kings. The monarchs of the world were waiting on him as servants. He was the lord of Indraprastha. He was the sole monarch of the world. He is the home of truth and righteousness. The great Yudhishthira, the lord of the world, is now honoring your throne by sitting on it. Do you object? You thought that he had no right to sit on your throne. Do you still think so? Tell us. Virata was speechless with amazement. He stood silent for a few moments. Then he said, If this is Yudhishthira, where are his brothers? Or rather, who are his brothers? Who is Arjuna? Who is Bhima? Who is Nakula? And who is Sahadeva? Is this the fire-born Draupadi? Please tell me and satisfy my curiosity. Arjuna told him who was who. He introduced them all to him. He sang the praises of the twins and that of Bhima. He showed Draupadi to him. Bhima introduced Arjuna to the king. Uttara Kumara came in just then. He said, Thank God, I am free to talk now. I can tell the whole world what happened on the battlefield. It was Arjuna who fought the battle for us. Father, I was the charioteer to the great Arjuna. He fell at the feet of the Pandavas and wept tears of joy. The king embraced Arjuna and said, God had been kind, God had been good to me. He made you save the life of my child. He fell at the feet of Yudhishthira. His form was drenched with tears. He took a chamara from one of the attendants and began to fan Yudhishthira. He washed the feet of Yudhishthira and said, I am the most fortunate man on this earth. Your presence has graced our city all these months. My court took on a new splendor because of your gracious presence. Please be good enough to accept my kingdom. I am your servant. I am your slave. In your infinite kindness and nobleness, you must forgive me for all the many indignities you had to suffer in my house. You are well known for your forgiving nature. You must have mercy on me and forgive me. Yudhishthira took his right hand in his hand and said, I am not angry with you. On the other hand, I am very pleased with you. We have been able to spend the most difficult year of our exile happily in your city. I have never enjoyed myself as I did all these months. I have enjoyed this year as I never thought I would. We have all been treated with affection by you. We came to you as strangers. Your gentleness and your noble qualities have won my heart. I am very happy to have you as my dear friend. Virata was grateful to Yudhishthira for his kind words. Uttarakumara came to the throne. He said to his father, We have been very fortunate in having the sons of Kunti in our midst all these months. They have been honored by you now. But I have a suggestion. Father, you remember you said that you would please the person who helped me during the fight with the Kauravas? You said that you wanted to give your daughter to him. It is time you fulfilled that promise. I will fetch my sister. Please give her to Arjuna, the greatest of all the heroes of the world. The young prince went out and came back with the princess Uttara. Virata smiled at Arjuna and said, Arjuna, this is my daughter. Arjuna, this my daughter has been your pupil for the last so many months. I will be greatly honored if you will accept her for wife. He fell at the feet of Yudhishthira and said, Please forgive us our faults and show me that you have forgiven us by accepting my child as the bride of your brother. Yudhishthira looked at Arjuna as if to ask him what he should say in reply to the words of Virata. Arjuna got up from his seat and said, My lord, we do not want the kingdom of Matsyas. We want only your assurance that you will give us your support when the war begins. This child, this Uttara, has been offered to me. I thank you for your loving thoughts which prompted you to do it. I appreciate it, but I cannot accept her as my bride. My lord, this child has been my student. She has been like a daughter to me. I cannot take her for wife now. It will not be right. He saw disappointment writ on the faces of Virata and Uttarakumara. He smiled at them and said, Please do not let this disappoint you. I will still accept her. She has been my daughter all these days and she will still be my daughter. I will be her father. She will become my daughter-in-law. I will accept her as the bride of my child, Abhimanyu. He is the son of Subhadra. He is the nephew of Krishna. He will be a fit husband for my favorite student. Arjuna smiled at Uttara and took her on his lap. He said, My child, Uttara, from today you are my daughter. Yudhishthira was pleased with the words of Arjuna. There arrived in the court of Virata a messenger from Hastinapura. He came to the court of Virata when Yudhishthira was there with his brothers. He said, These are the words of my king Duryodhana. You must prepare yourself to go to the forest for another 12 years. Arjuna, one of the Pandavas, was seen by us before the expiry of the 13th year. This is the message that has been sent to you. Yudhishthira laughed loud and long. He said, Go back quickly to your lord, master and king, and give him my message. Let our revered grandfather Bhishma say whether the 13th year has been completed or not. In a few days, he will get a message from me. ask him to be ready to answer that question of mine. Till then, ask him to leave us alone. Shri Krishnar Pranamastu. Chapter 22 of Virata Parva, The Wedding of Abhimanyu. News flew from one end of the world to the other that the Pandavas had come out of their Ajnatavasa, that their term of exile was over. There was no other topic of conversation. People were everywhere discussing what the behavior of Duryodhana would be. The Pandavas took for themselves the city called Upaplavya. It belonged to Virata. Yudhishthira sent messengers to all his friends and well-wishers. The first of these beings, of course, Krishna and Drupada. They hurried to Upaplavya. Balarama was the first to arrive. He was followed by Krishna, who was accompanied by Subhadra and her son Abhimanyu. The meeting between Pandavas and Krishna was very tender. The host of the Vrishnis had arrived. The Pandavas with Virata went to the outskirts of the city to receive Krishna and Balarama. They fell at their feet. Their eyes swam in tears. They said, "By your grace, Krishna, we have finished 13 years. You are our Lord and friend. We are in your hands. You are our refuge. We will do what you want us to do. We have no mind of our own. We are yours and you are ours. We are yours and you are ours. You mean everything to us." Krishna was overcome with emotion when he looked at his dear cousins. His eyes flowed like a river. Draupadi was as much upset as he was. They could not talk for a long time. Tears choked their voices. They stood silent. Krishna took the hands of Draupadi and lifted her up. He dried her tears with his fingers. He said, "No, Draupadi, do not weep. The time for tears is over. Smile now. The day is near when your smile can come back to your face. Dry your lovely eyes. I will set about fulfilling the promise I gave you in the Kamyaka forest 13 years back. The sickness in your heart will be cured soon." They entered Upaplavya. All the kings who loved Yudhishthira had come there. They were all pleased that they were meeting Yudhishthira and his brothers after the 13 years of exile. They were glad that Virata had been their host for 1 year. The marriage of Abhimanyu was to be celebrated soon. All the kings stayed on to attend the wedding. The wedding was celebrated with great joy. Young Abhimanyu looked like his father and his uncle Krishna. He was the most handsome bridegroom that ever sat before the sacred fire. The bride was a perfect mate for this young lion. They made a beautiful pair as they sat before the sacred fire. Dhaumya was the officiating priest for the Pandavas. Krishna and Arjuna sat side by side, smiling often at each other. The city of Virata was like heaven on earth. The marriage was a fitting end to their years of pain. It made them forget the past few years. It made them forget all that. They did not remember the pain of the past. So many years in the joy of seeing their child happy. It was a delicious moment which they enjoyed as much as they could, since they knew that it was just a respite. Great things were waiting to be discussed. The future of Bharatavarsha hung in the balance. But that was all for tomorrow. Today was the wedding day of their dear child Abhimanyu. They refused to think of anything except the love, light in the eye of Abhimanyu and the shy response in the eyes of Uttara. The guests who had come to attend the wedding were there with their armies. They had all come there to assure Yudhishthira that their army was at his disposal. Drupada, the sons of Draupadi, Drishtadyumna, Shikhandin were all there. The cousins of Krishna, Kritavarma and Satyaki were there. Draupadi and Subhadra were the queens in the palace. Sudeshna was now the maid in attendance. The palace of the king looked like the home of Indra. The Pandavas were very happy. Balarama and Krishna were shining there in the hall like the sun and the moon. All the others were but stars in attendance. Great was the happiness in the heart of everyone during the days of the wedding of Abhimanyu. Krishnam Vande Jagadguru. Jai Shri Krishna. Krishnar Pranamastha. Iti Virata Parva Samaptaha.